Hi, I'm Torben Janssen from thoughtsonjava.org. Today I will show you three options to map localized data and discuss the pros and cons of each of them. The first one is the easiest approach and a great fit for static data. But if you need to be able to edit or add new translations, I recommend using the third one. We have used that one in several client projects and it works really well after you got used to the additional complexity. But before we start, if this is your first time here and you want to learn how to create your entity mappings with ease, build incredible efficient persistence layers with Hibernate and all types of other Java persistence related stuff, start now by subscribing and clicking the bell so you don't miss anything. Internationalization not only affects the UI. If your application stores user-generated data and supports multiple languages, you also need a way to store different translations in your database. Typical examples are marketplaces that allow you to provide product descriptions in various languages, travel sites that offer trips to people all over the world, and document management systems that store document descriptions and keywords for multiple languages. In all of these examples, you need to localize your frontend and parts of the persisted data. The two most common approaches for that are using Java's resource bundles and storing the translations in the database. Let's take a look at the resource bundle first. This standard Java feature provides a simple to use and very efficient option to implement internationalization. You need to provide a properties file for each local you want to support. You can then use the resource bundle class to get the property for the currently active locale. The only downside of this approach is that the different translations are hard to maintain. If you want to add, change, or remove the translation of a property, you need to edit one or more properties files. In the worst case, that might even require a redeployment of your application. That makes Java's resource bundle a good option for all static, predefined texts like general messages or attribute names that you use in your UI. But if you want to translate user-generated content or any other string that gets often changed, you should prefer a different approach. You get more flexibility, and updating a translated name or description is much easier if you persist the localized data in your database. That makes it a great approach for all user-generated content. Unfortunately, the implementation is also more complicated. There is no standard Java feature that you can easily use. You need to design your table model accordingly, and you need to implement the read and update routines yourself. In this tutorial, I want to focus on the second option. There are a few commonly used patterns that enable you to store and handle localized information in your database easily. Let's first take a look at the table model before we discuss how you can map it with Hibernate. To make that easier to understand, I will use the following example. We want to create a marketplace in which suppliers can offer their products. The marketplace supports the languages German and English. The supplier can provide the name and description of a product in both languages. As so often, you can model this in various ways. Shantanu Kher created a great overview of different options and discussed their advantages and disadvantages on the Vertabello blog. I will add a link to it to the description box. Even though the popularity of these approaches varies, I have seen all of them in real life. In my experience, the most commonly used ones are using separate columns for each language in the same database table, for example, modeling the columns description underscore en and description underscore de to store different translations of a product description. Storing translated fields in a separate table is another option. That would move the description underscore en and description underscore de columns to a different table. Let's call it localized product. Let's take a closer look at both options. The general idea of this approach is simple. For each localized attribute and language you need to support, you add an extra column to your table. Depending on the number of supported languages and localized attributes, this can result in a vast amount of additional columns. If you want to translate four attributes into five different languages, you would need to model 4 × 5, which are 20 database columns. In the previously described example, you need 4 database columns to localize the product name and description. You use the columns description underscore en and description underscore de to persist the different translations of the product description. the columns name underscore en and name underscore de to store the localized product name. As you have seen in the previous diagram, using separate columns for each translation results in a straightforward table model. The same is true for the entity mapping. The ID attribute is of type long and maps the primary key. The generated value annotation tells Hibernate to use a database sequence to generate unique primary key values. In this example, I use Hibernate's default sequence. But as I showed in a previous article, you can easily provide your own sequence. The version attribute is used for optimistic locking and provides a highly scalable way to avoid concurrent updates. I explain it in more details in my Hibernate Performance Tuning online training. The supplier attribute defines the owning side of a many-to-one association to the supplier entity. As for all-to-one associations, you should make sure to set the fetch type to lazy to avoid unnecessary queries and performance problems. The name DE, name EN, description DE, and description EN attributes just map each of the localized columns. That might result in a lot of attributes, but it is also a simple and efficient way to handle localized data. You can use these entity attributes in the same way as any other entity attributes. When you persist a new product entity, you call the setter methods of each localized name attribute with the translated version of the product name. Hibernate then includes these columns in the SQL insert statement and stores all translations in the database. If you use my recommended logging configuration for development systems, you can see the executed SQL statements in the log file. And when you fetch an entity from the database, you can call the getter methods for your preferred local to retrieve the translated name and description. In the following example, I use the getNameEN and getDescriptionEN methods to get the English version of the product name and description. As you can see in the log messages, Hibernate uses a simple, efficient SQL statement to get the product entity with the given ID. As you have seen, adding a dedicated column for each translation to your table is very easy to implement in the table model. It's also very easy to map to an entity and enables you to fetch all translations with a simple query that doesn't require any join clauses. But on the downside, this mapping might require a lot of database columns if you need to translate multiple attributes into various languages. Fetching an entity loads translations that you might not use in your use case, and you need to update the database schema if you need to support a new language. In my experience, the inflexibility of this approach is the biggest downside. If your application is successful, your users and sales team will request additional translations. The required schema update makes supporting a new language much harder than it should be. You not only need to implement and test that change, but you also need to update your database without interrupting your live system. The next approach avoids these problems, and I therefore recommend it for most applications. Instead of storing all the information in the same database table, you can also separate the translated and non-translated field into two tables. That enables you to model a one-to-many association between the non-translated fields and the different localizations. Here you can see a table model that applies this approach to the previously discussed example. The localized product table stores the different translations of the product name and description. As you can see in the diagram, that table contains a record for each localization of a product. So if you want to store an English and a German name and description of your product, the localized product table contains two records for that product. And if you are going to support an additional language, you only need to add another record to the localized product table instead of changing your table model. The entity model is almost identical to the table model. You map the non-translated columns of the product table to the product entity and the translated columns of the localized product table to the localized product entity. And between these two entity classes, you can model a managed many-to-one association. The following mapping of the localized product entity consists of a few mandatory and an optional part. Let's first talk about the mandatory mapping of the primary key and the association to the product entity. The localized product entity represents the too-many side of the association. The product attribute therefore owns the relationship definition. The join column annotation tells Hibernate to use the ID column of the localized product table as the foreign key column. And the maps ID annotation defines that the primary key value of the associated product entity is part of the composite primary key of the localized product entity. It gets mapped to the ID attribute of the primary key class. As I explain in great details in my advanced Hibernate online training, you can map a composite primary key in various ways with JPA and Hibernate. In this example, I use an embedded ID and an embeddable called localized ID. As you can see in the code, the localized ID class is a basic Java class which implements the serializable interface and is annotated with embeddable. And because you want to use it as an embedded ID, you also need to make sure to implement the equals and hashcode methods. Okay, these were the necessary mapping parts of the localized product entity. They map the composite primary key and the association to the product entity. If you want to take it one step further, you might also want to cache the localized product entity. You can do that by activating the cache in your persistence.xml configuration and by annotating the localized product entity with JPA's cacheable or Hibernate's cache annotation. As I explained in my Hibernate performance tuning online training, caching is a two-edged sword. It can provide substantial performance benefits, but also introduce an overhead which can slow down your application. You need to make sure that you only change data that gets often read, but only rarely changed. In most applications, that's the case for localized strings. That makes them excellent candidates for caching. After we map the localized product table, which represents the different translations of the localized fields, it's time to work on the mapping of the product table. The only difference to the previous example is the mapping of the localized attributes. Instead of mapping an attribute for each translation, I'm using the localization's attribute. It maps the referencing side of the many-to-one association to the localized product entity to a Java util map. This is one of the more advanced association mappings defined by the JPA specification, and I explained it in great details in how to map an association as a Java util map. In this example, I used the local attribute of the localized product entity as the key and the localized product entity as the value of the map. The local is mapped by the localized ID embeddable, and I need to specify the path localized ID.local in the map key annotation. The mapping to a Java util map makes accessing a specific translation in your business code more comfortable, and it doesn't affect how Hibernate fetches the association from the database. In your JPQL or criteria queries, you can use this association in the same way as any other managed relationship. If you want to make your entity model more comfortable to use, you could activate orphan removal for the association. That is a general best practice for one-to-many associations that model a parent-child relationship, in which the child can't exist without its parent. It tells your JPA implementation, for example Hibernate, to delete the child entity as soon as its association to the parent entity gets removed. I use it in this example to remove all localized product entity as soon as it's no longer associated with the product entity. Another thing you could do to improve the usability of your entities is to provide getter methods that return the product name and description for a given locale. If you implement additional getter methods to return a localized name and description, you need to keep in mind that they are accessing a lazily fetched one-to-many association. That triggers an additional SQL select statement if the association isn't already fetched from the database. You can avoid that by using a join fetch clause or an entity graph to initialize the association while loading your product entity. And if you activated the second level cache on the localized product entity, you should also annotate the localization's attribute with Hibernate's cache annotation. That tells Hibernate to cache the association between these two entities. If you missed this annotation, Hibernate will execute a query that retrieves the associated localized product entities, even though they might be already in the cache. That is another example of how complex caching with Hibernate can be. It's also one of the reasons why the Hibernate Performance Tuning Online Training includes a very detailed lecture about it. Using this mapping is a little harder than the previous one. The translations are now mapped by an associated entity. It gets a little bit easier if you activate Cascade Type Persist so that you can persist your product entity, and Hibernate automatically cascades this operation to all associated localized product entities. And because I modeled a bidirectional association between the product and the localized product entity, I always need to make sure to update both ends of the relationship. Due to the utility methods that return a product name and description for a given locale, retrieving a specific set of translations is very easy. But please keep in mind that these getter methods use the managed association and might cause an additional SQL statement to fetch the localized product entities. Storing your translations in a separate table is a little more complicated, but it provides several benefits. Each new translation is stored as a new record in the localized product table. That enables you to store new translations without changing your table model. Hibernate's second level cache provides an easy way to cache the different localizations. In my experience, other attributes of an entity, for example the price, change more often than the translations of a name or description. It can therefore be a good idea to separate the localizations from the rest of the data to be able to cache them efficiently. But the mapping also has a few disadvantages. If you want to access the localized attributes, Hibernate needs to execute an additional query to fetch the associated localized product entities. You can avoid that by initializing the association when loading the product entity. Fetching associated localized product entities might load translations that you don't need for your use case. Using additional columns to store the translations of a field might seem like the most natural and obvious choice. But as I showed you in this video, it's very inflexible. Supporting an additional language requires you to change your table and your domain model. You should therefore avoid this approach and store the translated and non-translated information in two separate database tables. You can then map each table to an entity and model a one-to-many association between them. This approach allows you to add new translations without changing your domain and table model. But the mapping is also a little more complicated, and Hibernate needs to execute an additional query to retrieve the different localizations. You can avoid these queries by activating the second level cache. Okay, that's it for today. If you want to learn more about Hibernate, you should join the free Thoughts on Java library. It gives you free access to a lot of member-only content, like a cheat sheet for this video and an ebook about using native queries with JPA and Hibernate. I'll add the link to it to the video description below. And if you liked today's video, please give it a thumbs up and subscribe below. Bye!